Nighttime on Still Waters. This is NB506812, narrowcasting into the night from somewhere on Britain's waterways.
October 31st, Thursday. Samhain, Old Hallow's Eve. Still air. Wood smoke blends with night mist. A tawny's call shivers across the fields to the south. I pass a couple of boats with pumpkin jack-o'-lanterns grinning candlelight onto their bows. The distant music of memories swirl me loose from my moorings, casting me adrift into the night times of my boyhood. It's a still, breathless night tonight, under a starless sky heavy with cloud. Earlier, a distant firework display reflected palely off the clouds. Summer lightning in November. Where we're tied up tonight, it's not far from a fairly busy road, and the still air carries the occasional sound of traffic across the fields and up the canal. A train rattles southward. Opposite us, the hunched bulk of a crack willow, almost leafless, crouches beside the canal, only just a little darker than the night around it. And this is the narrowboat Erica, narrowcasting into the darkness of a starless and moonless November night, to you, wherever you are. It's lovely to see you, and I'm so glad that you could come. I put the kettle on ready and made sure the biscuit barrel is full. There's a comfy chair awaiting you, so come inside and welcome aboard. All along the towpath, crimson hawthorn berries smoulder warm among the mud and leaf fall. Rusty wires of sorrel stem, garnet red, stand stark along the canal edge where a few weeks ago green clouds of watermint, mallow and willow herb grew. And tall fists of burdock, stripped and withered to the bone, hold thistly burrs like old-fashioned sea mines to the coats of dogs and other passers-by. And desiccated blackberries, hanging clusters. They fall apart in my mouth and lie tasteless and gritty on my tongue. Well, that's what you get for eating fruit that the devil has weed on. And everywhere there are tiny red fires among the dripping browns and the time-worn greens. Rosehip, bryony and cuckoo pint, although these are all but over. And every now and then, pinpricks of Cerise Herb Roberts' delicate petals, remembering the touch of spring and summer days that suffuse these canal banks with birdsong and the dance of insect wing. Or perhaps they're just promising the summer's yet to come. And these days, even on the stillest of days, leaves fall. Ash twist and spiral lazily, like yellowing green mottled salmon. And small eddies of air catch and play with them before they settle on mud and water. And the local kingfisher turns his coppery chest to me as he flies in long looping strides along the opposite bank. And well he might. His hennaed waistcoat matches exactly the autumn golds and the auburns and russets, tawnies and chestnuts of the turning world all around him. And even the flash of his blue looks dull in contrast to the autumn fire of his chest. And the polestar oak has now almost lost all of its leaves, clothed now in light and air. However, on the hill, the convocation of oaks are still thick with foliage, throwing their familiar summer silhouettes against the autumnal sky. And the cormorant, oiled slick and spear sharp, has been making a presence real recently, as lithe and agile in air as in water. At each dive, the water closes over the sleek black body with barely a ripple. And the ducks appear clumsy and oafish in comparison, but then they too take to the air, almost vertical, trailing a chandelier of light behind them. But then there's always more than just one way to show mastery of an element. And the cygnet is becoming more and more independent, and is, for all intents and purposes, self-sufficient. Most times I see it on its own. Its parents still seem to accept its company. At least, I haven't seen any attempts to drive it away. And from what I can tell, parents usually only do that, if they need to, once they have learnt to fly. Donna says that she saw them together flapping their wings, building and stretching those all-important flight muscles, but I haven't seen anything of it yet. Sometimes the cygnet still swims and forages with Mum, and Dad too seems fine. But there is an undeniable slow parting of the ways, the adolescent stage, locking themselves away in the bedroom and falling into an uncommunicative silence at the dinner table. Such is the way of growing up among human, and it seems also swan families. And it's well, soon this little territory will only be big enough for the parents again, as they look to the next round of nest building, laying, hatching and rearing. And besides, hopefully all things being well, there are new worlds that await this remaining cygnet. It's a great joy and pleasure to welcome another Lock Wheeler to our band. So hello and welcome to Lois Raphael. And thank you very much indeed. And it's really appreciated. Thank you. And it's also lovely to hear from so many of you who've dropped me an email or left a comment. Thank you. Hello to Jason Polite and to Sherry Rauch and Tracy Thomas. And hello also to LJ and Bodie. And thank you to everyone also who sent messages of concern or well wishes following my social media post about having to take the flu from our stove out. Now all is back in place and we can once more use it. And in relation to something completely different, it all coincided with a question that Lee wrote to me about. And what I'm going to do is I'll explain what happened and how everything got sorted when I answer Lee's question in a future podcast. And Lee, I am also thinking about you particularly this week. Greetings also to Mind Shambles. And hello also to Andrea Hansen and Gregory Hansen too, but more on this a little later on. And a huge thank you to all of our Lock Wheelers for supporting this podcast. They are Lois Raphael, Sammy Walbury, Tania Jorge, Andrea Hansen, Chris Hines, David Durham, Chris and Alan, on the narrowboat, the land of green ginger. Captain Arlo, Rebecca Russell, Alison on the narrowboat mucker, Derek and Pauline on Silver Fox, Anna V, Orange Cookie, Donna Kelly, Mary Keane, Tony Rutherford, Arabella Holtzapfel, Rory with MJ and Kayla, Narrowboat Precious Jet, Linda Reynolds Birkins, Richard Noble, Carol Ferguson, Tracy Thomas, Mark and Tricia Stowe, and Madeline Smith. Thank you. Welcome. You found me. That's great. This is NB506812, the Erica coming to you from somewhere on Britain's waterways. To start with, just a few notes of explanation.
The NB in the title stands for narrow boat, and the 506812 is our registration number. All boats are required to be registered.
It now seems all so long ago. That first episode of Nighttime on Still Waters. 4th of October, 2020. The turmoil of the pandemic raged about us. And socially, within the media, if not in local reality, things had begun to spiral. At times it did feel as if we were on this little island, surrounded by a deepening night, and the need to find new ways to reach out to say, I am here, and I see you too. We're not alone. But also to find ways to celebrate and somehow acknowledge by making a record of all those other more than human lives whose company were becoming more and more important to me here. And I can remember my finger hovering over and then drawing back many times from that big green button that published the uploaded file and sent it out beyond my control into a different kind of darkness. For unintentionally in those days, I realized that within that file, there was a piece of me that I was releasing with it, unprotected, into an unknown world. It was a feeling that I've grown more used to, but it is still always there. That final, dare I? In some ways, things have not really progressed far from those first episodes. Those beautiful passages from Charlie Connolly's The Last Train to Hilversum, recalling the magic of radio, still resonate deeply within me. And duck calls in the night still play an important part of my daily life, or nightly life, as demonstrated just a few episodes back with the constellation of ducks. And I still have just one listener, you. Though your shape tends to fluctuate and morph with time, and you have become much richer and deeper and wiser, and you've taught me so much. However, in other ways, as we both grow and develop and let our curiosities choose the path we are to walk, it seems as if we've covered some miles. And the night doesn't seem quite so dark or lonely. And tonight, as I sit here in this small circle of light that shines down upon the desk, all that you bring to this meeting, the small details of your life, the flora and fauna, the climate, the place names that I have only known from a map, all the things commonplace and unremarkable to you, but so exotic to me, flow around me, naturally merging like a swirl of nighttime mist with this strip of canal glinting under a sky full of stars and owl call. And along with the brush and rustle of reeds, there is dry desert heat too, and big skies over prairies, and mountain forests, and the crash of surf, and the cascade of streams that tumble down a hillside, the rush and brush of sirens in cityscapes, the dark alleys. I'm not sure how accurate it is, but the statistics according to the platform host for this podcast, so it only has a fairly restricted reach, shows that this podcast has been listened to in over 6,184 cities across the globe, covering 134 different countries and territories. So yes, we have covered some miles together, and the journey is the richer for it. Me here, you there, sharing this pool of light in the darkness of our night, under one moon. The magic of radio, And that magic is captured so perfectly in his poem Slow Radio by Seán Street. At the tone, the time will be that night when the glass glowed before the sound came. The moment recorded itself, and outside there were reeds at the winter's edge. There was a north wind across marshland. That night, by the lake, when the old boat that would never float again moved slightly as the waves brushed it through the grasses, as the lapping seeped through. And the song, when it came gradually, from a crackle like a throat clearing. And when you heard the tone, it was 1957, and it was worth the set's tuning. The dark, whispering across the reed beds with the hiss of a distant signal in place of what was lost. While the amber-lit wireless smile, once warmed, stayed constant. And what struck me from my most recent reading of it was that sense of place that Seán evokes. And it's true that radio, and let's be indulgent and include narrowcasted podcasts here, as well as broadcasted radio, that it's true that radio can transport us to the most wonderful and vivid places in our imaginations. I can still remember listening in our front room at home to Dylan Thomas's Under Milkwood on our old Val radio that smelt of burnt dust when you first turned it on, and how it took me to the surreal, dreamlike little Welsh fishing village with its slow, black, crow-blacked cobble streets and fishing boat bobbing waves that slapped against the harbour walls. But it also rooted me in my memory into my own world, the four of us and two dogs, sitting in a semicircle around the fire and the night falling outside the bay windows, and the tall cypress tree by the garden gate, and the occasional vehicle passing on the A41, and the rattle of a freight train clattering along on the other side of the valley. Or sitting on the beach wall while eating chips out of a paper packet soggy with vinegar at Sheringham, while listening to Friday Night Is Music Night being played on the loudspeakers of the lifeboat station. Radio can transport us away to wonderful places, but it can also magically root us more firmly in our own particular landscapes. And I was reminded of this by something wonderful that happened a week or so ago. Well, actually, there were a couple of things, but I'll get to the other one later. A few weeks ago, one of our Lockwheelers and listeners, Andrea Hansen, got in touch with me about her brother, Gregory Hansen, to say that he was a professor at Arkansas State University, where he teaches heritage studies and has a special interest in myth and folklore, and that he'd listened to the podcast and had really enjoyed the episode on the children of the children of Lur. Well, last week, Andrea contacted me again to say that Gregory had used the episode The Sun That Shone on Eden as part of a course that he runs, and had attached some excerpts from reflective essays that his students had written. Well, first of all, I was delighted and flabbergasted in equal measure that an episode could be useful in this way. And secondly, it was an episode that I'd entirely forgotten about. And when Andrea wrote about The Sun That Shone on Eden Still Shines on Us Now, I immediately thought, what a great phrase. I must look up where it has come from. However, my delight was nothing compared to that when I read them. I was genuinely moved that the podcast could not just evoke such a response, but that it was treated so seriously and insightfully. And first, hello, Gregory, and thank you again. And it was great to correspond with you. And thank you for all of the information that you emailed to me about the work that you do over there. And as I wrote to you, I'm particularly appreciated the reading list. I can see that my books to read list is going to get considerably longer in the near future. All I can say is that it's a good job that the nights are drawing in and there's plenty of reading time that lies ahead of me. And if by any chance any of your students are listening, then hello and thank you too. And I hope you don't mind that I am taking the liberty to read out a couple of extracts from them, as they seem to go right to the heart of not what I've just been talking about with the magic of radio and by extension podcasts, but go right to the heart of this podcast and its primary ethos of finding connections with each other and the soil. And I love the connection made by Imad and Abigail between that episode and Keith Basso's wonderful book, Wisdom Sits in Places. I'm glad that you could see such a connection there. And it was an idea that I was playing with, as well as the work of those two Welsh poets, as Will mentions. In that episode, I think one of the assumptions or ideas that I was trying to push back against a little is that sometimes I feel my lack of, for want of a better word, heritage and my rootlessness, or at least an overwhelming awareness of the shallowness of those roots when it comes to my relationship with my local landscape. Historically, in large swathes of Britain, culturally, our roots with the landscape have been loosened, and we lack that rich heritage of both indigenous American and Welsh cultures, which, no matter how persecuted and threatened, still exist to some extent within both these lands and landscapes. In other words, can I still find those anchors or places that don't just root me, but talked and teach me, as Basso notes, in 21st century Britain, within a local landscape within which I have no actual historical connection with? And here, Abigail's words struck me particularly powerfully, as in seeking these connections and finding a sense of place within the landscape seemed to work not just locally here, but also with the landscapes, unknown and alien in the most positive sense of the word, to me. When she wrote, "Look how easily the land accepts your footfall," says Richard Good, as he describes a place many listeners have never been to. Yet we feel as though we have, due to his rich description. We are physically transported through words. And this is echoed by Constance's comment that the podcast resulted in making one want to walk around the countryside to connect with nature and the land. And I'm so glad it did. And Will made a particularly perceptive observation, and one that's given me a lot to reflect upon. He wrote, "While listening to the episode, The Sun That Shone on Eden, from the Nighttime on Stillwater's podcast, I naturally drew comparisons to Wisdom Sits in Places by Keith Basso. Both ultimately look at nature through a nostalgic lens of the past." And it was Will's really interesting choice of wording and his use of nostalgia that got me thinking. It's something that I am very aware that features heavily in this podcast. This nostalgic sense of the past, a personal and personalized sense of history. And such as it is, it's really useful for creating connections, individually but also socially. Most feedback that I get from the episodes is generally about how something that I have said triggers a memory or a shared experience. But there is also a danger with it. I'm aware that nostalgia, by its very nature, is not only highly subjective, but also it can be exclusionary. Exclusionary in the sense that it's limited by specificity. It's meaningful to me, but might fail to provide any useful handholds for someone else, or for you listening. And Will goes on to draw upon this contrast by noting that my use of nostalgia is individualistic, in contrast to the example of the Welsh poets who had drawn upon what he refers to as collective nostalgia. That's really interesting. That line between recalling a past historically and nostalgia seems to me quite slippery and elusive. What's the tipping point between remembering historical events and nostalgia? It would be really interesting to hear how Eleanor Gwynn, the poet who is recording the old names of fields and sea areas, would respond to this question. Let me stress that Will is certainly not being critical or negative about this. He's simply observing how the two processes work. And I think that he makes a very fair point, and one that, although perhaps not expressed so clearly as Will does it here, has troubled me for a while. If you've been listening to this podcast for any length of time, you'll be aware that I'm very influenced by the writings of John Moriarty. And Moriarty talks about sheltering stories, narratives, myths, if you like, that direct our lives and preserve our sense of being. His main argument is that the great meta-sheltering stories of the West, namely the Greek myths, and to a certain extent, the biblical ones too, have now failed us. And much of his work was to find new stories, or actually rediscover older ones. And the big question for me is, in the framing that Will presents it, are my nostalgic stories big enough, robust enough, to create a sheltering story that is of use beyond the individual? Can a culture survive on, a fragmented collection of individual personal stories? And this is a big question, and I'm not likely to find the answer to it quite yet. But in this regard, I did find a comment made by Jeannie Marie especially insightful and helpful. She wrote, "Both Basso and Good share stories that focus on lessons from nature, especially as they align with preservation and moral teachings. Good emphasizes learning through lived experiences, while Basso illustrates how the Apaches pass down information through stories that they tie to specific areas. Both Good and Basso reflect on how lessons are often learned from experiences that one gains from nature." Yes, I think you're right, Jeannie Marie. The handing down of community tradition in Basso's case, the remembering of lived experiences in mine, is an important distinction between what I was doing and what Basso was recording, and one that I had not noticed before. Reading your comment reminded me vaguely of something that I'd read, and I can't quite pin it down. I think it might be from Sharon Blackie. But in cultures now impoverished of such rich tradition and heritage, perhaps this use of preserving and codifying, is that the right word? Lived experiences might be the key to regaining at least some sort of connection, and might be more important and powerful than I first thought. Perhaps to answer my earlier question, our culture, and I'm referring here to post-industrial West, without having these older indigenous stories, we need to enter a time of storytelling again and form again the stories of our home to live by. And it's so good to see that this is appearing to actually happen. And perhaps it's actually really just a normal part of life that we're just not aware of. Brandy provided a lovely example of exactly this. She wrote, "As I listened to this podcast, I was engulfed in memories. Memories of my aunt who taught me about wild plants that can be used for food and medicine. As we walked in the same places that she walked in her childhood, she taught me the old names of those plants and how they must be prepared. My mother passed when I was young, so it was her sister who shared this heritage with me. It brought back memories of old place names here in my hometown that are not used anymore. These are names I learnt from my grandparents. For example, Gibson's Switch comes to mind. It's a place in Valley View, Arkansas, where the trains switch tracks. The old switch station is no longer in use, but there is rich history in places where few of this generation know the names." That's a great example, and I'm also so glad that you enjoyed this calm journey into heritage. And Chandria also provided a really lovely insight that I found particularly encouraging and heartening. And she wrote, "Funny enough, I listened to this episode while I was repotting a black shield alocosia, is that how you pronounce it, that had outgrown the pot it came in. As I listened and dug through the dirt, I was transported back to my childhood, to my grandmother's backyard. Every summer, my grandmother would pick me up to help put new plants into her garden bed. In reality, she directed from the patio and let me have fun with the dirty work. The plant she favoured the most was what we commonly call elephant's ears. I hated those plants. They reminded me of those dinosaurs that flared out their necks in defence. And pulling myself back from that memory, I chuckled as I put the small black elephant ear into its new pot, covered its roots with dirt, and placed it near the window, alongside a larger dinosaur-resembling plant that would have terrified me as a child. In my mind, these are the plants that I'll be planting in my yard, if they survive that long. Calling them by the name she calls all flowers of that variety makes me feel that I'm imitating her. Much like what Keith Basso points out about the importance of names in Wisdom Sits in Places. Although the name is of a plant and not of a place, it takes me back to one. Tending to them makes me feel back at home, in my grandmother's garden." And I think that last line, Chandria, "Tending to them makes me feel back at home in my grandmother's garden," is so important. Especially to those of us who, like me, are trying to reconnect back to their rootedness within the landscapes that they find themselves in and yet feel culturally unrooted from. I think that although probably not realizing the depth of what I was saying and was perhaps what I was trying to articulate with my reference to Mum teaching me about the nettle and the dock leaf, many of us find ourselves through jobs or other circumstances in locations to which we have no sense of belonging or history. We might love the landscape, the flora and fauna. We might enjoy being out in nature, going for walks, watching the views. But that deep sense of feeling at home there can at times be difficult. And I think your example is so rich in explaining how, while our circumstances and even attitudes might change, there's also something within those memories, to use Jeannie Marie's phrase, lived experience, that can help to heal that rupture and restore us back to our sense of being home. Well, I especially have loved the way that so many listening to me talking about the small world in which I inhabit, the land, the soil, water, the small communities that live within it, through this oral medium, in some way made it possible for you to feel a little bit more embedded, rooted, part of your own lived experiences and lived spaces. It's that magic of radio that Seán describes in his poem, Slow Radio. My own experience of being transported and yet at the same time rooted. And so too here with you. And I'm so grateful that you've been open and generous enough to share it and let me know about it. So thank you to everyone for such thoughtful and perceptive reflections. And thank you to Gregory for creating this opportunity. And perhaps that epitomizes why I love doing these podcasts and the heart that beats throughout them, sending these words out into our darkness to find connections with each other, no matter how geographically or socially different we might be, and the often fractured and bruised landscapes in which we find ourselves in. And to realize that the sun that shone on Eden does still shine on us today. And that brings me on to the second really wonderful thing that happened recently. And that was when I received a poem by Archie from Tacoma, Washington. I didn't know I did mention it in the last episode, but I wanted to be able to give it a proper space. And Archie wrote to say that, I've been trying to carry your magic into my own world by looking for the poetry in the simple things around me. Thank you for teaching me. And Archie captured it and expressed it so beautifully in this, his poem called The Narrowcaster.
8.7 degrees centigrade. Inside, 18 degrees. Humidity, 94%. Wind direction. Backing, northwesterly, westerly. Strength, 15 to 21 miles per hour. Barometric pressure.
A man speaks softly into the microphone. His voice low, steady, carrying stories like wind carries whispers. No pen, no page. Just sound weaving itself into something timeless. He doesn't just tell stories, he spins them, each word mapped in meaning, floating through the air, finding you wherever you are. You listen, drawn in, as if his voice could pull you from your world and drop you into another. But it's not fantasy he offers. It's life. Seen through a different lens, stretched into tales that leave a mark. A lesson in every twist, truth in every pause. His words settle like quiet rain, soaking into the soul of your thoughts, rooting deeper than you expect. He is the storyteller who doesn't just want you to listen. He wants you to learn, to feel, to walk away changed, carrying a piece of his magic into your own world. Thank you, Archie. This is the Narrowboat Erica, signing off for the night. And wishing you a very restful and peaceful night. Good night. Temperature outside 11.9 degrees. Inside 22 degrees. Humidity 95%. Dew point 11 degrees. Wind direction, east. Wind strength, 2 miles per hour. Barometric pressure, 1030.5, rising. Cloud cover, 87%. Cloud ceiling, 6,200 feet. Precipitation, nil. Moon phase, 1.8%, waxing crescent. Day length, 9 hours 30 minutes. Sunset, 16:35. Sky casting, 7:07.